The Raspberry Pi is used a lot as a network bridge, and that's great. But it does have sound quality limits, although these are more and more tackled by manufacturers like Allo, as with this SPDIF board for the Pi. From the start of the SPDIF and DAC boards for Raspberry Pi small board computers, there were several potential problems influencing the sound quality. Dirty power, high frequency noise from digital circuits and clocking problems of the audio boards. Clocking was taken care of by a master mode for the DAC and SPDIF boards. When used, the Raspberry Pi has to listen to the audio board on when to send the next bunch of audio data. Jitter then only depends on the quality of the clock crystal on the audio board. The dirty power problem knows many ways of solving. Using an audiophile power supply is one, although that doesn't solve the noise problem caused by the Raspberry Pi. It helps if the audio board is powered and that power is then relayed to the Raspberry Pi. Using two power supplies, one for the Raspberry Pi and one for the audio board, further improves the sound quality, although still the noise will leak over the ground plane. You can of course use all kinds of techniques to separate each circuit from another, like is done in the Project Streambox S2 Ultra, but that can't be done using a normal Raspberry Pi, for you can't modify the Pi easily. It can be done on the audio board of course, and that's what Allo did with their DigiOne SPDIF board I reviewed a year ago. They had 10 low drop voltage regulators on the thing, and I then found it to be the best SPDIF output board for the Pi I had reviewed. And now they introduce a signature version of the DigiOne. The size of the Raspberry Pi more or less dictates the size of the audio board. If you want more board space, you could make a board that's bigger than the Pi. But a more elegant solution is to use two boards piggyback style. And so they did. The smaller board that is the closest to the Pi is the dirty board, with on top of it the clean board. The dirty board holds the I2S to SPDIF converter, a Wolfson WM8805 chip, and connects to the Pi over the 40-pin GPIO connector. On the other side of the board, an 8-pin connector links to the clean board. On the clean board, a quad-channel isolator provides complete isolation from the dirty board of both ground and signals. This board has two USB-C connectors to connect two power supplies to, one for the dirty side and one for the clean side. The Raspberry Pi and the dirty board receive power from the dirty connector. The idea is you can use a simple 5-volt DC 3-amp switch mode power supply, while for the clean side you can use an audiophile grade 5 to 6-volt DC power supply that only has to be able to supply 100 milliamps. And that can also come from quality rechargeable lithium-ion batteries. To provide an even cleaner power, there is a supercapacitor on the rear of the clean board that buffers a few seconds of operational power for the clean side. The all-important clock oscillator is mounted under a shield as it should. According to Allo, it hides a high-precision NDK oscillator that should result in better than 400 femtosecond jitter at a buffer. You can order the DigiOne Signature fully assembled, including the Raspberry Pi, an acrylic housing and either Volumio or Diet Pi pre-installed. If you go for the last option, you do need to run Diet Pi once, having a monitor and keyboard attached to the Pi, to have it install the software of choice. See my review of the Allo US Bridge at 3 minute 21 for more info on this. All parts are also available separately. I have used the Ropier software to make the DigiOne Signature Player a Rune endpoint. Allo made sure that the DigiOne driver also worked for the Signature version, so it will work with almost all popular software. I powered the Signature in several ways. From two S-Booster linear power supplies, one of the previous generation and one the smaller first generation to power the dirty side. I also used a cheap switch mode power supply from Allo on the dirty side and a battery pack on the clean side. Allo offers a battery pack for only $475, the matching 18650 lithium ion batteries cost around a tenner and you need at least two. The battery pack is modified to run two pairs of batteries in parallel so that when you buy four batteries it doubles the playing time. As a result, the illustration in the pack should be ignored. The battery should be inserted with a negative pole towards the springs. You also need a suitable charger costing around €30. Since the DigiOne signature has USB-C power inputs, you might also need a pair of adapter cables. When you order the complete set, these are included. When powering up, you need to connect power to the clean board first, followed by the dirty board, so the software sees the clean board on startup. The rest is up to the software of choice. I used Rune on an Intel NUC server and the Rune user interface on an iPad Air 2. But if I had installed Volumio, this would not be much different, apart from the player's user interface itself, of course. In all cases, the maximum sampling rate is 192 kHz, which is normal for SPDIF. Connection to the DAC is made over a very sturdy BNC or ditto RCA connector. An optical output is left out. Optical is rather limited in bandwidth and thus a waste on the signature. The influence of a digital source is far greater than many can imagine. See my video Network Music Video Player's Quality for more info. Therefore, a decent burning in period of at least a week and often more has to be taken into account. All components change behavior over time, especially the clock oscillator becomes far more stable when burned in. I even don't switch off network bridges and DACs for that reason. The power consumption is low and it does pay if you own a well installed decent stereo. I had the DigiOne signature player running 24/7 for 10 days and it came from a fair player to an impressive player for the money. So I moved it from my setup 2 to my setup 1, where it was connected to the MyTech Brooklyn. I started with the two S boosters as described before. The overall impression was of a dynamic sound with a deep and wide stereo image. Instruments were well in focus, although not at the level of the SMS 200 Ultra Neo, and if I had to guess, also not at the level of the Project Streambox S2 Ultra. But since it already left, I couldn't do a direct comparison. Furthermore, the SOTM and the Project both output USB and not SPDIF, and it's hard to say to what degree that makes a difference. The low end that also can suffer from jitter reached fabulously deep and showed fine texture and tonality. Switching to the Allo switch mode wall ward and the battery pack only changed the sound minutely. I even wonder how many people would even notice, for it was not a tonal change, just pace and rhythm that reduced slightly. In non-audiophile speak, it has a tad less drive, as if the musicians had been playing for a longer period, supported by small amounts of alcoholic beverages. But again, it was a minute difference. Overall, the signature fits my setup 1 being at the lower end. Quite an achievement for a Raspberry Pi sound card. Let's talk prices first. Allo advertises in US dollars, while for Europeans an indication in euros is given. So let's use the US prices this time. The complete player will set you back $315, and that's excluding sales tax. The DigiOne signature SPDIF cards only are $239 excluding sales tax. You do need two power supplies too, the cheapest option being a wall ward switch mode power supply plus a battery set that in total will set you back an extra $85. Plus you then need to charge the batteries after use. I played with two batteries in the battery pack and two in the charger. but I prefer using the S-Booster solution, costing €300. The Signature is already the most expensive audio board for the Raspberry Pi I have reviewed, and it only does SPDIF. But if you are looking for a network bridge or streamer that outputs SPDIF to your DAC, it's also by far the best choice I know, provided your DAC is of equal or better quality. The design team in Toulouse in the south of France that does the Allo audio products seems to strive for the ultimate. Manufacturing, by the way, is done in Bangalore, India. It makes you wonder what they come up next year and if the competition comes up with an answer. Want to stay informed? Subscribe to this channel or follow me on the social media. If you like this video, please consider supporting the channel through Patreon or PayPal. Any financial support is much appreciated and needed to keep me independent. The links are in the comments below this video in YouTube. Help me to help even more people enjoy music at home by telling your friends on the web about this channel. I'm Hans Beekhuizen. Thank you for watching and see you in the next show or on thehbproject.com. And whatever you do, enjoy the music.